No. A surgeon is trained to read the x-ray. He has seen lots of x-rays. So he can compare his mind and eye and look at many x-rays. I can write about my x-ray, but his interpretation and reading of the x-ray has authority because he has been trained to read the x-ray. So John has apostolic authority to interpret these visions because he's been with Jesus for 3.5 years. And in those 3.5 years, Jesus has trained him to understand the Old Testament. Right? So as he's walking with these disciples on the road to Emmaus, he is telling them their own scriptures. But he is helping them to understand the scriptures, how to read, how to interpret the Old Testament. So these apostles have apostolic authority, A, because they have learned directly from Jesus, but Jesus has not taught them in a vacuum. He has used the Old Testament, that was his scriptures. They have been reading the Old Testament, which Jesus acknowledges is God's word. So that has shaped their mind. Then they are baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit. So John's authority to write this comes from the fact that he is in the Spirit on the Lord's day. So Holy Spirit is inspiring him. But that inspiration is not in vacuum. He is, when we use language, we use a language common in our culture, so we understand each other what words mean. His language is shaped by the Old Testament. Not just the word, but also the images that he is using. So light is an image which is coming from Isaiah and many other passages. But life, the river of the water of life, the tree, the leaves, these are all images from the Old Testament. How would have John's readers understood these words? These phrases, that is what we've been looking at every day and having fascinating discussions. And these are very practical implications. That if the Word of God is about the healing of the nations, blessings of the nations, then obviously our nation needs that healing. We are a sick nation. We are experiencing that. We can't hide that. We are a sick nation. So what is here that can bring healing to the nations is what we want to look at. And one image that we have alluded, though that's not the central, is that this city is the light. Now which city is he talking about? Even before that, I suppose it would be appropriate. How many brides does Jesus have? If the church is his bride, is he tired of his bride and given up on her and then decides to marry a city? No. He knew how sinful his bride is before he married her. So Ephesians 5 tells us that he married a bride which was terrible. So Ephesians 5, husbands, verse 25, is it? 23, 24, 25, yes. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water and the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So Jesus already knew what his bride is like before he married her, sinful. You know, when my wife and I have conflict, we've been married for what, 42, 43 years. I get angry, and she can get angry. And then I sulk. And I, next day I make sure that when I'm having my quiet time, I'm reading the Old Testament and not the New Testament. But the Lord still says, do you love me? Yes, I love you, that's why I'm reading your word. Well, if you love me, then obey my commandments. Which ones? Oh, you know, husbands, love your wives. But Lord, look at the wife you gave me. He says, no, you don't look at the wife I gave you. You look at the wife I gave to my son. That's you. I gave her this bride, which is full of wrinkles and dirty spots, ugly and everything, so that he might shed his blood to sanctify, make her pure, present her to himself, pure, holy. Now that's the transformation. Jesus is out to make all things new, beginning with his church. So in chapter 2 and chapter 3, there's letters to seven churches. That's an expert looking at an X-ray. That X-ray could be from a famous athlete who has won dozens of gold medals in the Olympics. But the surgeon doesn't look at those gold medals. Film stars, the politicians. He's looking at the disease, the heart, the essence of who you are. So Jesus sees the church and he's transforming the church and making her the light to the world, that the nations will. That's what Isaiah is saying repeatedly. Let's look, for example, Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60, he is saying that arise and shine, for your light has come. Isaiah 60. There are many verses before Isaiah 60. But from 60, he especially is talking about New Jerusalem, New Heaven and the New Earth. The phrase New Heaven and the New Earth comes in Isaiah 65. So he says in Isaiah 60 verse 1, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth. We certainly see that in India. And thick darkness the people. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you, and nations shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. So you shine, that's what Jesus is saying, let your light shine. You shine because your light has come upon you. You are not the light, you're the lampstand. You're the city. The light has come upon you. And you will be radiant. The earth is covered with darkness. Therefore, nations shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. With all the reference systems available, you can pursue this theme of the light with which John is concluding that he is taking us to. He's taking John to see the bride, and it's a city coming out of heaven. What does that mean? Is this city being built somewhere beyond the blue and will come like a UFO? Or is the city, the bride, being built here on this earth? Let's look at Galatians chapter 4. The image in Galatians chapter 4 he's discussing Sarah and Hagar in chapter 4, and he says from verse 24, now these two women may be interpreted allegorically, Galatians 4 verse 24. These women are two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai, bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. Now Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia. She corresponds to the present Jerusalem, the old Jerusalem. for she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, and she is our mother. We are children of New Jerusalem. And he goes on into description. So we, in the Christians in Galatia, are already children of New Jerusalem, who is our mother. Hebrews 10. Let's turn to Hebrews Hebrews 12, verses 22 and verse 22. But you have come. Actually, you could read from earlier because he's comparing those the same image. That you didn't haven't come to Mount Sinai, but to Mount Zion. So we're reading from verse 12 of Hebrews, verse 18 of Hebrews 12. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given, if even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. So that's Mount Sinai. Even indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But, verse 22, you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who is enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, etc. So you have already come to the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. So this is the mindset of the New Testament writers, that New Jerusalem is not being built somewhere beyond the blue, it's being built here. Now John tells us, the book of Revelation tells us in chapter 2, in Revelation 2, in the writing to the, it's Revelation 3:12. Yeah, Revelation 3:12. That yes, you are a church with many defeated people, despairing people, people who have given up. But he says in Revelation 3:12, the one who conquers, and Jesus is going to make us conquerors. We will triumph over the devil with the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. The one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. Never shall he go out of it. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. So Jesus is saying that I'm actually building the New Jerusalem here on this earth. If you conquer through the blood of the Lamb, through the word of your testimony, I will make you a pillar in the temple of my God, and there is no temple there in New Jerusalem, but I will make you a pillar in the temple of my God, and I will write my name and the name of New Jerusalem, which is coming out of heaven. So at least the pillars of New Jerusalem are being built, and you are that pillar, and you can't get out of it. So wherever you go, the temple goes there, because you are the pillar, right? So New Jerusalem is being built here. This is going to be his radiant bride. See the picture? So let's take that further from one or two more angles. In we studied 2-3 days ago, chapter 12 of Revelation. This idea of New Jerusalem flying in as a UFO, and a great sign, this is Revelation 12, and a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and was crying out in birth pains and the agony of giving birth. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns. And on his head seven diadems, his tail swept a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour it. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron. But her child was caught up to God and to his throne, and the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God, in which she is to be nourished for 1260 days, that's 3.5 years. Now a war arose in heaven, and we can skip the war. Heaven is not a very peaceful place, because there is war in heaven. But we'll talk about heaven another time. He goes on to say in verse 13, and when the dragon saw that he had been thrown down, the serpent had been thrown down earlier, he's thrown down again because he was still actually in heaven, accusing the brethren day and night. So the word heaven doesn't mean what you learned in Sunday school. Well, now that I'm there, I might as well take a few more comments. I didn't intend to, but I should. See, we have certain images, for certain vocabulary which we bring to the text. But actually, you have to let the text tell you what the author means. So, let us change my mind. Let's read. Will be war in heaven. Verse 7. Now war arose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was defeated, that is, the dragon was defeated. And there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brothers, who has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God, and they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto their death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in a great wrath, because he knows that his time is short. And when the dragon saw that he had been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. But the woman was given the two wings of the great eagle, so that she might fly from the serpent into the wilderness, to the place where she is to be nourished for a time, and times, and half a time, 3.5 years. The serpent poured water like a river out of his mouth after the woman, to sweep her away with a flood. But the earth came to help to the help of the woman, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed the river that the dragon had poured from his mouth. Then the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her offspring. So here are a little complicated and terrible pictures as you read this passage. You assume that Satan was thrown out of heaven before Adam and Eve sinned. Therefore he came to the garden and deceived them. Now that's an interpretation which John Milton, the Puritan poet, wrote in The Paradise Lost, and Hollywood is making a movie on it right now. So for 300-400 years, the church has interpreted Isaiah 14 as the fall of Satan. But here actually, when the seventh trumpet is being blown, Satan is still in heaven day and night. So he's not just visiting heaven. He is in heaven accusing the brothers before God day and night. So we have to grow out of our Sunday school image of heaven, because the word heaven here is a terrible place where there is a war. Now, the word heaven doesn't mean one single place. So the Bible actually itself talks about third heaven, popularly seven heavens. The spheres, it's one word which is meaning the non-material realm. So when Jesus says, what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, Who are we binding? Who lives in heaven? God? Angels? Saints? Are we binding saints? No, we're binding demons. What you bind on earth will be bound in heaven means there are evil forces, spiritual forces in heaven that we are binding. So your understanding of heaven has to be a little complex. So Paul is saying, put on the full armor of God, for we are not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against spiritual forces of wickedness in heavenly places. So the word heavenly is a little more complicated, more nuanced than we normally think about it. So what it is not our subject right now. The subject is the woman. Who is this woman that is pregnant, in labor pain, about to give birth, and dragon wants to devour that son? Is it Mary? Because that male child will rule the nation with a rod of iron. Or is it the New Jerusalem? Our mother, as we saw in Galatians 4. Mary didn't have a crown. So verse 3 says, another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, woman is, verse 1. And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. That's not an image of Mary. She isn't running away from the serpent. The serpent isn't throwing water like a river to sweep her away. Her child is caught up, but this child is going to rule. But she has more children on this earth. And the dragon, because he can't get after these children who have already gone to heaven, this child that has already gone to heaven, he's going after the rest of her offspring. So there's no indication that Satan was chasing the offspring of Mary. He was interested in devouring Christ, and he did kill Christ. So the image really is of New Jerusalem. She's our mother. Some of his children have already been beheaded. So we see that when the fifth seal is broken, they are there under the altar, asking the Lord, how long? And they are told, when will you judge the world and the serpent? You rest here until the number of those who are to be beheaded is completed. So Satan is making war against the rest of the children. So the image of the New Jerusalem as our mother is that she is given wings like eagle and she has disappeared from the scene. There are persecuted children of hers. But now in chapter 21, after the serpent has been thrown into the lake of fire, she comes back flying. That's the image. But more importantly, this image of being taken to a high mountain to see the city in whose light the nations will walk. That image is from Isaiah 2 and Micah 4. Let's look at the Isaiah 2 version. Though they're very similar, Isaiah 2 to Micah 4. As though Micah memorized Isaiah and is quoting him. So Isaiah 2. The picture which brings us back to the healing of the nations, Isaiah 2. The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw. So he's seeing the word. This vision. John copies that. It's John's vision, what he saw, that he's describing. So the word that Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. It shall come to pass in the latter days. So all the things that are going to be terrible in the latter days. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be lifted up above the hills, and all the nations shall flow to it, and many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall decide disputes for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. So this is repeated practically verbatim in Micah 4. That what will happen in the last days? The mountain of the Lord shall be lifted higher than all the other mountains. Nations shall flow to it. Because we're walking in darkness, we need light. Many people shall come and say, come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways. Your word is the path, the light, the lamp unto my path, light unto my feet. And they'll say, let us go to Zion, for out of Zion shall go the law, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, he shall decide disputes for people, many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, instruments of agriculture, and their spears into pruning hooks, that be horticultural engineering. A nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. They will go for development. For, O house of Jacob, come let us walk in the light of the Lord. That's the sort of imagery that John is picking up in Revelation. And the healing of the nations. Before I come to that, I can give a practical illustration. They will turn their weapons into instruments of agriculture and horticulture. When you read this in Micah, to illustrate my point, let's read it inside in Micah 4. He says, concluding this from verse 1, it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. Mm-hmm. So that's the image from Revelation 21. People shall flow to it, and they shall, he will judge, verse 5, is it 3? He will judge between many peoples, and shall decide for strong nations far away, and they shall beat their swords into plowshare, and their spears into pruning hooks. And it says in verse 4, but they shall sit every man under his vine, under his fig tree, no one shall make them afraid. And in the other place where this is quoted, it says people will invite each other under their vine and fig tree and have good parties. No one making them afraid. Now these verses don't mean very much to us from our churches and seminaries. But George Washington, the first president of the United States of America, who led the victorious armies of the 13 colonies against the professional army of England, he used these verses 48 times in his, once he became president, he was only one time president, once he became president, these verses he used 48 times in his formal prayers as a president, in his writings, in his speeches. Why are we fighting against the British Empire? Why do we want a nation? So that everyone might sit under his own vine, under his own fig tree. He was a farmer. And his beautiful farm, which is still there outside of Washington, D.C. And no one making them afraid, so that there could be agricultural development. And America did go on to become the world's bread basket. In India, the agricultural revolution in 1970s, we used to have famines. Today we export food even though we have plenty of hungry people. We are the world's number one producer of milk. How did this happen? India becoming a land flowing with milk and honey. Three critical men who changed agriculture in India. William Carey, we have his biography. He was the first. He was here as a Bible translator, Baptist missionary to establish churches. But he made himself the first agriculture minister of India. No king, no Badshah had ever had an agricultural ministry. Therefore, he established the Agri-Horticultural Society of India. You go to Calcutta, you enter into the Agri-Horticultural Society, you see his marble bust welcoming you. You go in, ask them for the original minutes of the society, lots of minutes in his beautiful handwriting, which you can read from today, very well preserved. He was teaching people how to grow potatoes and how to plant forests, and he was teaching botany and agriculture and forestry in his university, Sarampur University. He was the second best botanical garden in India that was washed away in two floods, but his rock collection, collected rocks from India, are still there. There are several plants that are named after him in Latin, in botanical taxonomy. So he was the first person. Second person was Sam Higginbotham, and I'm a professor in Sam Higginbotham University of Agriculture, Technology and Sciences. He was a philosopher who came from New England, a prodigy of Dale Moody, to evangelize lower class Harijans, that time Dalits now, in Etah Manpuri area, but Presbyterian Christian told him to go to Allahabad, teach economics, and he said, I don't know economics. This, he said, well, you learn and teach. So he started reading economics and teaching it, and he found that none of the books and theories had any application to UP, because there was no bank, no industry, no manufacturing, no stock exchange, no insurance company, nothing. So as he began, how do I teach economics? So he began to take his students to everywhere where economic activity was happening. I'm giving you a practical illustration of what it means to bring healing to the nations. He finally saw that it is in central Jil Naini, where Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru spent a lot of his time. That's where the best economic activity was happening. There was a British military commander, a colonel, who was made the jailer. And he made a decision that every prisoner who comes into his jail must go out as a better person. So he began teaching them agriculture. He had to teach himself how to make a chula, which is fuel efficient and doesn't give smoke to women. So prisoners go back, they care for their wives and their mothers who are cooking, that they should not be inhaling smoke. What to feed your cows and buffaloes and goats, how to grow the best vegetables and the best grain, etc. This is happening in the jail. So Sam Higginbotham decides that I will go back to America, study agriculture, much better than economics, come back and teach agriculture. So he bought this land full of ravines where my house is. And he transformed that area as the Agriculture Institute, which only 2 weeks ago, the state government, Akhilesh Yadav's government, made a full-fledged state university. And Dr. Arbilal, actually the Vice Chancellor, has been here in Goa in one of your churches, I was just told. So he was the second person. And the third person was Marvin Warlock, who won Nobel Prize in Agriculture. He was invited by Ashok Mehta and Mrs. Indira Gandhi to transform Indian agriculture. His biography is called The Man Who Saved a Billion Lives. He was a scientist agriculturist, but as clear a witness and evangelist as anyone, any missionary you can find. So he was someone who can testify to Mrs. Gandhi the gospel directly. He is the man who really brought the Green Revolution to India. But in between, you have a number of Bible-believing, born-again Christian evangelicals who transform Indian agriculture, was one military engineer who was asked to build the bridge over Rudapuri in Andhra, and he realized that build this bridge so that our armies can come move quickly. He said, no, we've got to build a dam here and build canal system. The dam will allow us to build the bridge, our armies can still move, but we are not here just to rule this continent, but we are here to bless this continent. And that's what transformed the agriculture in Andhra, likewise in Punjab, and part of it is in Kashmir now. All of that irrigation system was built by Christian engineers. So this image, which doesn't mean very much to us, that Jesus will transform agriculture and horticulture, has actually been happening in India. Unfortunately, we don't study our own history because all we are interested in is when the third temple will be built and we will be raptured. Part of the reason why we are studying the book of Revelation differently or as it is to free ourselves from a kind of outlook that has destroyed Europe and is now destroying America. A theological outlook which we have swallowed, that we don't read the Revelation, we don't read the Bible for ourselves, we allow their interpretations to condition our mindset. That's partly what is happening. But for today, let me conclude this first session. We'll have to dig a lot deeper into what we just said. With the word nations, the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nation. The nations, that image is coming from Ezekiel 47, but we'll look at it tomorrow. Is God interested in nations? Leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. New Jerusalem.